Sanford Biggers. His work is some of the work that I look at the most myself, so it's a personal honor. First, I want to know more about our audience. So I'm wondering, how many of you are Ringling students? Fantastic. How many of you are Ringling faculty and staff? How many of you are visiting from another college, like New College? Thank you. Nice to see you. How many of you are board members or supporters of Ringling? Thank you very much for everything that you do for us. How many of you are members of the press? Hi, front and back. And how many of you are folks that are visiting from the Sarasota and surrounding community? Yay, thank you for coming to visit us. This lecture was made possible by the Hermitage Artists Retreat, the Greenfield Prize, and the Greenfield Foundation. And Bruce Rogers, who's the director of the Hermitage Retreat, is here, and he's going to speak a few minutes about the Greenfield Prize.
Thank you, Kim. And I'm going to speak for just 1 minute because you're not here to hear me. But I do want to acknowledge Bill and Joni Greenfield from the Greenfield Foundation, who are here with us. We actually have two Hermitage artists, two past Hermitage artists who are here with us. Meg Pierce and Malcolm Robertson are here. Malcolm, Meg, and that great man. I also, of course, need to thank the Ringling College for hosting us here and this afternoon with Sanford. It's just great to be able to bring people like Sanford to the college, and we really appreciate what you've done for us, and all the things that we do together, which are many. The Hermitage, for those of you who don't know, here's my quick elevator speech. The Hermitage is an organization that brings writers, painters, poets, composers, and playwrights to our community from around the world by invitation only, and for a bank of 6 weeks of time, which they get to spend in any increments they choose over 2 weeks. And in return for their residency, and they get living space and studio space on our campus on Manasota Key. And we also have a satellite space on the grounds of the John and Mabel Ringling Museum of Art. In return for the residency space, we ask them to do 2 free programs for the community in return. And those are done both up here in Sarasota, down in Charlotte County, down on our campus on the beach, and in the schools in Manatee, Sarasota, and Charlotte counties as well. That's the short elevator speech about the Hermitage. In 2008, the Hermitage was approached by Bob and Louise Greenfield. Bob was then the president of the Greenfield Foundation, which has been passed on to Bill, about creating a prize, a national prize. And that prize would be not for a past work by a playwright or by a visual artist or by a composer, but it would be in the form of a future work, an investment in a future work, and in the form of a commission. So that prize and the notion of that prize evolved into a $30,000 commission. It includes fundamentally unlimited residency at the Hermitage to create the work, a producing partner to work with the artist to develop the work while the artist is here, and then support for that work to be shown or exhibited or performed out into the greater world after it's been seen here first. That's the nature of what the whole prize is. And the artists who win the prize are given 2 years to realize their commission. So 2 years ago, Sanford was here and he received his Greenfield Prize. And what you will see in the John and Mabel Ringling Museum is the realization of that commission called Codex. And so I'm going to let Kim introduce Sanford, but that gives you a quick shorthand of the prize and why we're here and why Sanford's here. So, Kim?
A native of Los Angeles and current New York resident, Sanford Biggers works across disciplines and cultures, creating sculpture, video, photography, music, and photographs, incorporating icons and rites ranging from Japanese mandalas and slave quilts to hip-hop and YouTube music culture. Bigger's work connects the signifiers and patterns that link African spiritualism, Buddhist sacred rituals, and African-American urban culture. An accomplished musician, Bigger's often incorporates performative elements into his sculptures and installations, resulting in multi-layered works that act as anecdotal vignettes at once full of wit and clear formal intent. Bigger's has won several awards, and I probably am not going to be listing them all. He's already very accomplished. The Creative Time Travel Grant, Creative Capital Project Grant, New York Percent for the Arts Commission, Art Matters Grant, New York Foundation for the Arts Award in Performance Art and Multidisciplinary Work, the Lambert Fellowship in the Arts, Pennies from Heaven New York Community Trust Award, and the School of the Art Institute of Chicago Fellowship, James Nelson Raymond Fellowship, and the Camille Hanks Cosby Fellowship, as well as the Greenfield Prize that brought him to Florida. Sanford Bigger's installations, videos, and performances have appeared in so many exhibitions that it would take too long to list them all here for you verbally. But they include venues worldwide, including the Tate Britain and Tate Modern in London, the Whitney Museum and Studio Museum in Harlem, both in New York, and the Yerba Buena Center for the Arts in San Francisco, as well as institutions in China, Germany, Hungary, Japan, Poland, and Russia. Sanford has a major new installation at MassMoCA that's up right now called The Cartographer's Conundrum. And he also told me that he just won the Berlin Prize. He hasn't told very many people about that yet, he said, from the American Academy, and he'll be spending at some point 6 months in Berlin through that prize. Bigger's is presently a full-time faculty member at Columbia University in New York. Previous to that position, he taught at Virginia Commonwealth University's Sculpture and Expanded Media Program. Bigger's opened, as you heard, a new work, Codex, at the Ringling Museum just last night, and it will be on view through October 14th. Do I have that right? I think so. I'm excited that several of our fine arts students helped Bigger's with the installation of that work this week, and I want to thank him and the Ringling Museum for giving our students that opportunity. Would the students who participated please stand up? I know some of you are here. There's a few more here, they're being shy. Thank you. Would you please join me in welcoming Sanford Bigger's?
Hello? 1, 2, 1, 2. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
How are you guys doing?
Okay.
All right, good, responsive, that's a good sign. I'd first like to thank Bob and Louise Greenfield and the Greenfield Prize, the Hermitage, the Ringling Museum, and the Ringling College of Art and Design for hosting me, supporting me, and having me down here. It's been a great experience. Your weather is lovely. Seems like you have a monopoly on the sun down here. Glad to be in it for a little while. And we have a lot to discuss. As mentioned, I am an interdisciplinary artist. So I work in several different media, and this has been an issue for those tracking my career because they don't know exactly what category to put me in. I find that a strength, some people find that a weakness, a blessing and a curse, but we live in conundrums. It may seem a little schizophrenic the way I jump between medium, but I guarantee you there are some common threads that link them all together. Hopefully I'll be able to elucidate some of that for you today. But to show you a little bit of how my mind works and how I gather information and sources and references, I've compiled a brief montage, a little audio-visual montage that I think gives you a little insight. So if we can I turn down the lights a bit? And I'm going to be jumping between many different computer programs because I have new work and old work, so just bear with me as I switch through programs. We have volume on the computer? Oh, yes we do. All right, you might have to turn that down when you hear it, but here we go.
known, he'll be told, because you will never know what it is all about.
The unknown is eternal, because you will never know what it is all about.
So what will it be when you say, I do not know?
We sit in the house, and slowly the world we're living in is getting smaller, and all we say is, please, at least leave us alone in our living rooms. Let me have my toaster and my TV and my steel-belted radios, and I won't say anything. Just leave us alone. Well, I'm not going to leave you alone. I want you to get mad. I don't want you to protest. I don't want you to riot. I don't want you to write to your congressman, because I wouldn't know what to tell you to write. I don't know what to do about the depression and the inflation and the Russians and the crime in the street. All I know is that first, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm a human being. God damn it. My life has value. So, I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. I want you to get up right now and go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore. I want you to get up right now. Get up, go to your windows, open them, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell,
and I'm not going to take this anymore. Then we'll figure out what to do. But first, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore. Then we'll figure out what to do. But first, you've got to get mad. You've got to get angry. You've got to go out and say, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore. Then we'll figure it out. First, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm a human being, goddammit. I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Peasants, I want you all to go to your windows.
What?
Go to your windows and yell out, I'm tired of the drugs. I'm tired of the crack babies born out of wedlock to crackhead AIDS-infested parents. I'm tired of the inflated welfare rules while good, wholesome Americans bring less and less of their paycheck home every 2 weeks. I'm tired. You're tired. We're all
see how you would play.
Poor modeling professional athletes. Cousins, I want you to go to your windows. Yell out! Scream with all the light you can muster up inside your bruised and battered, assaulted bodies. I'm sick and tired of niggas, and I'm not going to take it anymore!
That boy's up there. Boy, he get to talking to me. Lord have mercy, he done did it again.
Thank you. center of the Vandana brings to mind the configuration of Mount Kailash, believed by many to be the center of the physical and spiritual universe. We asked the Dalai Lama for his views on this.
But then is the question whether Mount Kailash is the center of the universe. That I don't know. each country, they believe, you see, their own country is the center of the whole universe. I think that's very true. I think ultimately, we ourselves, one individual, that is the center of the universe. So for me, this place, it's the center of the universe, because the conception of the whole universe comes from here. So therefore, I'm the center of the universe. So similarly, your case, you are the center of the whole universe.
Thank you. It makes me feel very good. I shouldn't tell my wife.
Okay, so hopefully you're very confused now. That's how we like to start the day. So I don't think it was mentioned before, but I spent around 3 years living in Nagoya, Japan in the middle of the 90s. And I went there to study Japanese, to teach English, and also while I was there, I became very interested in Buddhism. And you'll see that theme coming through a lot of the work that I'll show you today, and even in the quilts and the artworks that are at the museum right now. So I'll start with this piece, which during that time, when I came back to the States around 1996 or 97, I was speaking to a mentor of mine, and we started talking about autobiography and how important it was, or if it was important at all. And as a sculptor and starting to look at the field of installation art, I wanted to find ways to speak about life experiences that were very personal, but at the same time were entryways for other people to engage the work. So I might have a set, one or two, maybe even three ideas per piece, but that's just a gateway for other people to bring their thoughts and their interests and their past experiences into the work for multiple readings. So with that in mind, I started to do my first series of mandalas, and a mandala is a Buddhist image that is often thought of as a symbol for the universe. Jung studied them as well, so he looked at those as doorways to the mind, to the psychology. And usually they're depicted with a central Buddha or deity in the center and several around the sides. So with that in mind, I started to construct these mandalas made out of hand-cut rubber tiles. So what you're looking at here is first, well, the third dance floor I did. And these are all 1-inch square, 1-foot square tiles that are cut into this pattern. And then later I would take them to events around New York City. And can we turn the lights down a little too? Thank you. Introduced and involved in the burgeoning hip-hop arts, the b-boy arts, that is. So I was breakdancing, I was emceeing, doing graffiti, and DJing. And also, one of the reasons I got into painting as a fine artist was because I used to do graffiti in Los Angeles and I got busted when I was around 15 and 16. So I was immediately put into formal art education and started taking AP art classes. So the notion of autobiography comes into play here because me and my friends, in our pursuit of the b-boy arts, would meet at one guy's house every week, and we would practice our moves and wear our breakdancing outfits, and it was like going to a dojo and practicing a martial art. So when I got exposed to Buddhism and this notion of the sort of monastic life of meditation, I thought about some of the energy and the experiences of breakdancing back in Los Angeles, and that's where these dance floors came out of. And as you saw in that montage in the beginning, that overhead Busby Berkeley camera angle was also part of how this was realized. And the thing that was particularly satisfying about this project was I was invited by the Rocksteady Crew and the New York City Breakers, the two original crews that made breakdancing popular, to make a stage for their annual breakdance contest. So the dancers had no idea that this would later be seen in a quote-unquote fine art. Venue. So for the first, this is actually shot at the Bronx Community College. This was not a non-art event. This was the Battle of the Boroughs, which is a b-boy contest every year. And they didn't realize that there was a video camera above filming them. But I told them all after, and then I invited them to come downtown when this was going to be shown at the PS1 clock tower. So several of the dancers showed up, and I had music there, and it was up to them. If they wanted to dance, they could. If they didn't want to, it was not imperative. It was more important to have them there because they helped make the piece. Because what you can't see, well, you can see a little bit here. The scuff marks are the traces that go with this piece everywhere it travels. And so far, it's been shown in Munich, Amsterdam, London, San Francisco. It's up at Emory right now. And everywhere it goes, every institution that shows it, they allot a few hours per week where dancers of any kind can come in and perform on the floor. So gradually, it starts to have this use patina. And I imagine once this is in a museum and looked at several years from now, this sort of shows the residue of the experiences and performances that took place on it. And I'll talk just a little bit over this. This was a piece I had in the Whitney Biennial in 2002, and this is called A Small World. It's going on view again at the Jewish Museum in New York next week. And it's a collaboration between myself and my friend Jennifer Zakin, who is a Jewish woman from Connecticut. We were in grad school together, and I was doing projects with Super 8 Film, and she told me she had several hours as well. So we compiled this. Thank you. But as you see, there's Christmas and Hanukkah, Passover, Easter, fifth birthdays, trips to Disneyland, family barbecues. And through this project, we started to look at America as a culture of class as opposed to a culture of different culture, you know, ethnicities and cultural backgrounds. And this was a theory that was being thrown around a lot by sociologists at the time, and it was considering America as divided by tax bracket as opposed to individual lifestyle. And we sort of thought of this as a microcosm, because anyone who had access to a camera at this time has the exact same footage. They have the same birthday parties, the same dinners, the same rituals. And we even consider our fathers and our uncles to be the real authors behind this piece, because what we did was just compile what they had already shot and put away and had dust on it for 20 years or so. So in the Duchampian sense, this is actually a ready-made. And when we did this, we realized that there were such similar actions that we were able to switch screens a few times. And people, it takes a while for people to perceive that now this family, the Jewish family, is on the right side and the Black family is on the left. That's me with the boots on. I still play piano pretty much the same way. So when we did this as a full installation, we had to make a room that was appropriate, so we have the requisite shag carpet, simulated wood panels, love seat. And the cool thing about this as an installation was during the whole duration of the biennial, people would come in there and it'd get pretty crowded. So people started laying on the floor, getting very comfortable, and it really started to feel like a family room. And then later, it got the nickname as the makeout room, because the high school groups that were coming through would sort of hang out there when it was dark, and, you know, the rest. And, you know, as I mentioned, I'm working between video and installation and even discrete works like this. These are a few sculptures that I made that I call the Ghetto Bird Tunic series. I don't know if Florida terms are the same, but growing up on the West Coast, we started to call police helicopters the Ghetto Bird, because in certain vantage points through LA, you could see them going in circles around the hood, just like the cop cars are. So you would say the Ghetto Bird is out tonight, it's on the loose. And I was invited to do a project with Ellen Harvey and Ai Weiwei at the and Ann Chu at the Princeton University Museum of Art, where we were asked to do interventions with the existing artworks from the museum or to put our own works in there. And I did interventions in the Renaissance, pre-Columbian, African, and Greco-Roman section. And maybe I'll show you another slide if I can get out of this program in a minute. But this one, of course, I put into the African section in a vitrine. And right here, down at the bottom, written in museum lingo, it explains the ritual that as a coming of age, rites of passage event, young men have to put on this jacket, go into the street, and dodge the ghetto bird. And if they can do it successfully, they become a man. So this one is for teens. This one is for older men. And I made one for infants, because you could never start running from the cops too soon. And this was the first of several memorials I did for hip-hop, because hip-hop died a few years ago. And when it died, I had to usher out its death. I mean, don't get me wrong, there's something on the radio, but I think that's hip-hop, not hip-hop. But you could find it if you really look. But in commemoration of that, I made this piece, which is called The Bridge Is Over. And the title comes from a classic battle song between MC Shan and KRS-One between the Bronx and Queens in New York City. And I say all this because I really do look at these objects and the history of these objects as a way of studying ethnography, basically, cultural, urban ethnography, pop cultural ethnography, and so on. And with that in mind, it even goes international. I did another project to memorialize hip hop where I went back to Japan for 4 months and I made these traditional singing bowls. And these are popular in the Buddhist and Shinto traditions. They're often struck, and once you strike them, the sound permeates and you're basically, you obey and pray to your ancestors during the duration of that sound. Another way of using it is getting a mallet and rubbing it around the ring, around the rim of the bowl, and it creates a beautiful sound. To make these, I collected hip hop jewelry from Harlem. So fat gold chains, bracelets, necklaces, rings. Then I went to Tokyo and did the same because there was a lot of hip hop jewelry shops at the time. And I melted down, with the help of some traditional artisans in Tokyo, melted all those pieces of jewelry down into an alloy and then formed them into these singing bowls. This one, you can't tell by the slide, obviously, but it's around 3.5, maybe 4 inches diameter. So it's pretty petite. And then inscribed, it says Hip Hop Ni Sasagu, written in kanji, and it means in fond memory of hip hop. But to take it a step further, I started doing seated meditation at a temple 2 hours outside of Tokyo. And I would go every week and sit with the head monk, and he would sort of guide me through meditation. And after we built some type of rapport with each other, he invited me to do a performance at the temple. And for that, I invited 14 other participants, and he let us use some of the bowls that he had in his collection. This one right here is 200 years old. It's massive. It's around this large across, very deep bass sound to it. And me and my volunteers did an improvisational bell choir. So I wrote a musical script, which is very simple, that everyone can follow. It turns out that the score that I made for this, I actually depicted it as a drawing, and one of those drawings is in the quilts at the Codex show. And I'm gonna just go quickly to get some more recent work, but this is a pretty large piece I did in New York several years ago at Triple Candy. And this, influenced by the sand mandalas, is a prayer rug. And the materials here are colored sand poured directly on the floor. So if you get too close, if you sneeze, if you run past this, the whole thing will start to dissipate. It took around 300 hours, 5 people working daily to put this thing down. And then, of course, it was swept up in around 6 minutes. And the interesting thing is, during the opening of this show, a friend of mine brought his daughter. She was around 5 at the time. And there was around 100, 200 people standing around here. And she got freaked out and just bolted right across the whole thing. And, you know, there was a palpable gasp. The whole crowd was sighing. But I already got the picture, so I was okay. But she was so fast and so light that she just blurred one tiny part of the piece. And then everyone started to just go into applause and screaming and laughing. And she started crying hysterically and ran out of the place. She's like 9 now, hasn't spoken to me since. But you see, it's a very intricate piece. And I show this because a lot of my process is quite laborious. And then other times, it's not so laborious. I don't have much to say about that slide. Just like to put that in there. I was asked by Performa, which is the performance biennial that happens every couple of years in New York, to do a commission piece. And another part that I left out, I was trained as a musician as a kid, and then I left it aside for many years. And in the last 10 years or so, I started performing again. So before my art career started to take off in New York, I was doing a lot of musical gigs. And I met up with a lot of very talented musicians who I performed with. So when I was approached by Performa to do this piece, I enlisted the help of these musicians and singers and poets that I worked with in the past, including Martin Luther, Saul Williams, Estero, Shay Fiol, Imani Uzuri, many of which I've worked several times with since. And for this, I wanted to explore American musical theater. And the most, the first form of American musical theater was the minstrel show. And of course, this has a very weighted and troubled past, but I wanted to reinvestigate it. And so with that in mind, instead of putting on just a straight ahead minstrel show, I made what I call a post-minstrel cycle, which was using the tropes of the minstrel show, using a lot of the stock characters, and then making a new piece that was very critical about popular culture and politics. And so right here you're looking at Estero and Shea Fiol, two fantastic soul singers who just happen to be white women. And they're dressed as Southern Belles, and they're on a porch swing, and they're talking about slavery. And the rub is this: both of them were signed to very big record label deals, and those record labels put their projects on the shelf, so they were no longer able to release any music under their own name. So essentially, they had become slaves to the corporation. And here they are singing the Black National Anthem.
To love and heaven be, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening ears go. Let it resound, how is the call in sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing.
So the show consisted of around 7 or 8 different vignettes. And this was my MC, who was sort of dressed as a Cab Calloway character, wearing a fat gold chain that later turns out to be a fat gold noose. And I don't know if many of you remember the Gina 6 incident that happened in Louisiana around 2007-2008, where a black student wanted to sit under the tree where all the popular kids were sitting, and the minute he did, all the white kids left, and the next day there were nooses hanging from the tree. Well, that spurred a bunch of noose-related incidents that lasted for around 2 or 3 months. And this was during the time I did this performance, so of course we were playing with very current events. In this minstrel show, I didn't have any blackface, but I did have whiteface in the form of a geisha. So this is Imani Uzuri, dressed as a geisha. I actually had a professional geisha makeup artist come in and do her face. And then her outfit was that of a slave girl, a slave Piccaninny. So it was playing on the notion of comfort women from different times and different cultures, and she sings an a cappella version of Strange Fruit, the Billie Holiday classic. In the background is a video that I made called Shusher that features black men of varying professions climbing trees, getting comfortable, and hanging out in the trees as opposed to being hung from the trees. So here's a little clip of that. Ghetto bird tunic, of course, made an appearance as an outfit for Saul Williams, who was releasing a new project called Niggy Tardust, based on Ziggy Stardust, of course. And here's a quick clip of him.
Fucking with this black bug, make a Thomas a promise, leave a corpse in the furnace, bitch, make a gun, drink a dance, beg a waffle. Turn the blood, spill a bitch, steal a Mack truck. Bad luck, fucking with this black bug, make a Thomas a promise, leave a corpse in the furnace.
I mean to show you that just yet. So yeah, obviously that was a very provocative piece. And it was great because at the opening, it was a one-night show, and we did two shows that night, and we had a full house, and in the audience were people like Erykah Badu and Mos Def and Harry Belafonte, Lou Reed, Laurie Anderson, and the comments and responses that they had to it was overwhelming. It was a pretty amazing experience. I'm going to zoom forward and get to some very recent work. This is a piece called Blossom. And this is a sculpture, and the sound that you hear is really actually coming from the sculpture. So you're looking at a baby grand piano, which has been retrofitted into a player piano. And then I recorded myself doing jazz and gospel and improvisations. So when you walk into the space, the keys of the piano are moving, the pedals are moving, and it's basically singing to you. And the chair is kicked over, of course, because this too was inspired by that Gina 6 incident, which happened underneath a tree. So as if a body were lynched from this tree, that stool is kicked over. And this is a fabricated tree. It does appear very real, but it stands around 15 feet tall, and then it abruptly stops. And I like to keep that abrupt stop at the tip of the tree to let people know that it actually is fabricated. It's not to make an illusion of total reality, but to make you contemplate what you think is reality. Because here we are in 2007 or 2008 when that incident happened, which means though things change so much, they often don't change that much at all. And another version of the tree is this piece called Bittersweet Fruit, which is another tree with bottles around the bottom of it and a very small television monitor embedded right here into the trunk. Now, the original of this piece was made in 1999, and I did a newer version of it for a show recently in Philadelphia. But you can see those headphones hanging almost like hangman's nooses, and as viewers come up and put them on, they essentially get lynched. And the video they see on the inside was, I have to go a few inches back to find that for you. Hold on. So the video inside is a video of me doing, once again, jazz and gospel improvisations on a piano that I moved into the woods and let stay out there for 3 or 4 months. And I played it every single day just to sort of chart and document the way the sound changed as this piano went through different forms of destruction. By the end of the video, just my feet are hanging above the keys. And I'm going to bring you up to, like, right now. So I have just come off of a crazy season of solo exhibitions that started in New York in September. So I had a dual exhibition that was between the Sculpture Center and the Brooklyn Museum. And at the Brooklyn Museum, the show was called Sweet Funk. And it looked at around 10 years of my work, a very thematic survey show, basically. So looking at the tree pieces, and a few others that I didn't mention, but I'll briefly run through some of these images. These dance notations, it's a recurring theme in my work. This particular installation is called The Big Ass Bang, and it's essentially making constellations and universes appear throughout these dance notations. Located in the corner is a disco ball that's been modified, so it looks like it's disappearing into the wall, and as that spotlight hits it, creates all these different stars and universes, galaxies emanating from it, and the dance patterns fall into that as constellations. I'll find a better picture of this to tell you about this piece. Also a major part of that installation was this piece here. This is called Lotus, and this is a 7.5 foot diameter piece of glass that is hand etched with what I call a lotus blossom. And lotus is a symbol in Buddhism for perfection and harmony and peace. And lotuses go from the mud and the muck and mire of a pond and rise to the top and blossom into splendor. And with that metaphor, I thought it was perfect to make each of these petals out of this diagram right here. Sorry, I'm jumping in. So the closer you get, you realize that each of those petals is actually the cross section of a slave ship. And these are how bodies were organized to maximize the cargo hold when bringing human cargo from Africa. And then at the Sculpture Center, the centerpiece of that, the centerpiece of the Brooklyn show is the Blossom piece. And this is actually on view for the next 3 years. Not the entire show, but the piano itself is on view for the next several years. Up top, you can see another sculpture that's called Shesha, which you saw on my screensaver before we started the lecture. But it's a light box sculpture that's a big set of smiling lips. And I call it Shesha as a reference to Alice in Wonderland. And the piece was initially shown in Germany, outside of the Black Forest. Oh, there it is again. I'm gonna show you the original installation of that piece. So it's an outdoor piece initially. And it's supposed to just sort of hang from the tree. And being that it's a light box, it's on a timer, so every 5 minutes or so, the lights come on, they blink, and they do a dazzling show, and then it goes off. So it disappears and reappears, just like the Cheshire Cat. And that's pretty much how it was understood and taken when I showed it in Europe. But when I show that in the US, there's a whole other read that comes, gets heaped onto it. Of course, once again, it goes back to blackface minstrelsy and that tradition. And I've become very interested in how symbols and icons can operate differently in different contexts. And it sort of tests us as a viewer to see how beholden we are to previous definitions and meanings, and if we have the flexibility to see these things without that same baggage or pathology. So that's what it does when the lights are on. And I made a video project where I feature this very prominently. I like to consider it to be even a main character of the video. I think this next slide might be part of that video, yes. So in Germany, when I hung that piece, I also did a video to accompany it, and this is the video. Thank you. So this is the first part of a trilogy of films. This one shot in Stuttgart, Germany, with Ricardo Camilo, the main character. And it's basically, at least this one, is sort of about him confronting the image that he projects of himself outward, the images that people project back onto him, and this notion of putting on the mask and taking off the mask, which is something that most people do to navigate through society anyway. You have your face at home, your face at the job, your face at school. So the second part has been shot, and I shot that in Salvador da Bahia in Brazil 2 years ago, and it's part of the show that's at Mass MoCA right now. And I'm going to show you a few images from that show, and then I'll take some questions. So I don't know how many of you have been up to North Adams to Mass MoCA, but the space itself is literally larger than a football field, as large as an airplane hangar. Happens. And I was asked to do an installation which filled up not only this space, but back here behind that big white wall is a mezzanine, and then there's an upper mezzanine, well, the upper mezzanine right here, and then a lower mezzanine below it. So it's quite a task. But for that, I went back and started to go back into some of the floor pieces, and I made a 3,600 square foot floor piece right here. Instead of using the motif of the mandala, I wanted to play with geometry and pattern, very much like the geometry and pattern that's in the quilts that I've been making work from lately. And strewn throughout the space are old instruments, a pipe organ, saxophone and its case here. There's different clusters of instruments, found instruments and their cases all about, and also mirrored glass mirrors that have been cut into stars that are put on the ground, crushed, stepped on, so that when the light that emanates from all of these windows touches it, you get basically a star chamber and reflections everywhere. I also put gels on the window, so as you walk throughout the space, and as the sun moves throughout the outside and cast shadows that move throughout the space, you get those color rainbow type effects that are basically kinetic. One of the things that I wanted to challenge myself with for this installation was that it would never be seen the same way twice, because the sun is always going to be in a different position. Cloudy days render it a little bit less visible. Super bright days, it becomes like glares that you can't look in certain pockets of the room. You can get an idea right now of how the effects that occur on the walls and the ceiling as the light goes through their space. And right here on the ground is one of the main arteries of light that shifts throughout the day. And then in one of the back warehouses of the space, I found church pews, and I used them as found objects and placed them on the floor, but gradually I started to raise them off the ground up towards the ceiling. The higher they get, I started to fabricate colored plexiglass pews, so the sun also can shine through those and cast other colored shadows. And then at the front of that sort of congregation, if you will, is a suspended piano, and these spear-looking objects are pipe organs, or pipes from a pipe organ. And they even start to interfere with the architecture going through the walls and right through the space itself. And when you stand under this, this is happening orbitally. So you see this going pretty much, almost 360. Of course, it doesn't go through the ground, but every space above that, you have multiple points of impact. And this is the view from above, looking back down the space. Now downstairs, that second video that I mentioned, that's part of that trilogy, is shown on two large projection screens, and they are mirrored images. So What you're looking at is bodies walking through the space so you can get an idea of scale. They are massive screens, and they're multi-directional, so you can see them both from the front and the back. We're on the back side now, and these are columns that are part of the architecture of the space. And as you walk through, this is the unobstructed view of both of the screens that are actually acting together. To get through this space, you literally have to walk between them and around to the back. So it forces you to interact with it, and it forces you to sort of deal with that scale and the landscape. And as people watch you walk through it, you feel like you're walking into the ocean or into the city or whatever scene it may be on. And then upstairs, I reproduced a mural from my cousin, John Biggers, who's a well-known muralist who passed away around 12 years ago. And I recreated one of his paintings, which is appropriately called Quilting Party. And throughout this mural, the mural is around 28 feet, and there's all these beautiful pieces of geometry, areas of geometry, and string, and puppets descending from the heavens. So a lot of the ideas that are embedded in this mural are also physically available in the space. There's also a sound component as you walk through that main exhibition space. Some of the sound from the video is disjointed throughout the space. And in the far back is one of my quilt drawings. It is riffing off of the Biggers mural and the rest of the installation. And the rest of these images are all very recent quilts, but I won't show them because there's a show down the street that, of course, you should go see, and you can see them in person. So, I don't know if we have time for any questions and answers, but I think if you have any, this would be a great time. And I can cycle through some images if it's pertinent to the question or anything that responses you have. Yes?
First of all, what is your secret to find the time and energy to do all the different kind of works, music and sculpture and performance art? And the second question is, where did you get the idea of destroying musical instruments?
Mm-hmm. Okay, for the first question, I think I get the energy and the impetus to make all this different type of work, because if I made one type of work, I'd probably get bored. Mm-hmm. So doing something else keeps the energy going. And I find ways that, I mean, I think we're basically talking about visual communication or sonic communication, or communication on multiple levels. And I feel that sometimes sculpture can say something better than painting, and then maybe music can say something better than photography, or vice versa. So it's always finding what's the most appropriate medium for the idea that I want to get across. And destroying musical instruments, I typically don't destroy them. If they're destroyed, I find them that way. I modify them, and I think I resurrect some, because mostly these are old instruments when I start to do, you know, changing them into player pianos and so on. But a little secret, the piece that I showed you from Mass Mocha, let me get back to it really quickly, with the suspended piano, I was gonna destroy that one. The idea was to lift it up there and drop it down and then make that part of the installation. But when I got it up, I sort of liked how it felt just hanging there in space, because it's more of a pregnant pause. And to have that fall and conclude in this destruction, it sort of would have been the punchline, given the punchline before the joke was made, that type of thing. So I like to rely on the viewer to be an active part of any of these pieces. So to imagine this falling is something that the viewer has to do by themselves. Otherwise, they might imagine it, you know, levitating or floating upwards. So now there's more room for interpretation, I believe.
First of all, thank you for this. It's all enormously delightful. Could you describe or project the sound component to the quilts, and is that a part of what's at the museum?
Yeah, actually what I'll do is I'll just play a little bit of the video and you'll hear the sound, because the sound that's going throughout the space is related directly to the video. When you step into the video room, you hear the entire soundtrack. But in the installation, I have discrete speakers set up throughout that only play tidbits of that same soundtrack. So for example, there's a lot of waves. You might hear a minute of that, and then silence for 3 or 4 minutes. Then you might hear 15 seconds of chanting from a left speaker that disappears, and then maybe drums from a right speaker later. So it sort of massages the viewer through the space. Once again, that's the notion of this never being the same installation twice. You'll always come in at a different sound event or a different visual event. And I'll just keep it a little bit low so I can speak over. There's a question back there. Yes. Far back. I'm good. How are you?
My name is Harry, and that you might know.
Okay.
And it was put out that this crowd would be a little bit kind of not so nice as your mama. Well, you know, I've got a lot of names over the years. Now, they call me General, and they call me Moses. Now, some folks call me Miss.
Okay. So, what I think Moses back there is talking about is how I refer to Harriet Tubman as an astronaut. And by that I mean Harriet Tubman navigated the stars to take escaping slaves from the south to the north. So in my eyes, that sort of puts her up into a type of a stellar sphere as any other cosmonaut. Yeah, so basically, that's it. Yeah. Thank you.
How do you spell sketch out and model out or let your installations evolve? Like, how do you have a pieces in your apartment?
It depends. It really depends. Like for the installation here, I've been working on several of those quilts in my studio for a while. So I was able to, did you want this one, or this voice or this? Okay. So yeah, I had several little pieces in my studio, and it was about looking at the blueprints here and figuring out how to best arrange and which number I could put in that would fill the space appropriately. But for Mass Mocha, that place was just too big. And regardless of how many sketches I did and how often I referred to the floor plan, it really doesn't make any sense until you get into that space and you see the power of that immensity. Because even the piano tree piece that I have, which would look huge right here, in a space like that, it looks like a matchstick. So I had to go there and literally give up the notion of following the blueprints and say, okay, we just gotta start putting objects in here and arrange this like a huge, you know, just arrange it right here and improvise. So it's a little different. It depends on the project. And those are both site-specific. The one here is site-specific, and Mass Mocha, of course, is site-specific. Brooklyn, however, those were objects that had already been made. So it was, you know, a dance between the curator and myself to look at the blueprints and take her suggestions and my suggestions of where pieces should go.
So for Mass Mocha, from the start, from the moment you walked in the room until the day you got the thrill of it being completely assembled, how long was that?
I'd been going up there for 2 years. And then I started going very intensely the minute the Brooklyn show and the Sculpture Center show opened in September. I was going pretty much every week. And the major production of it started in December. And it was done by February. Sir?
Can you tell us about in that space, in Mass Mocha, one of the best elements in that space are those massive trusses in the ceiling. Mm-hmm. Does the piece extend up into the trusses?
Yes. Those pews that I showed you, they go all the way up. They don't go right up to the trusses, but they are supported by them. But another safeguard that I put in there are computer-controlled stage lights. There are four of them, and they are attached to the trusses. So if you go there and it's totally overcast and there's no light coming from outside, every 6 minutes or so, those come on and do, you know, sort of like a mega church routine where they start shooting light everywhere, and they pinpoint some of those mirror clusters on the ground and start projecting light. And the added benefit of that is that when the space closes, we keep that pattern going on to like 10 o'clock at night. So if you're driving by, you can see the lights shooting outside. They can. The quilts are an ongoing series, so I'm still making more. And depending on the themes based in the quilts, some are grouped together and some aren't. But essentially, they're modules that can be, lifted and moved around and changed. Yeah. Any other questions?
I just want to know about your studio practice.
Oh man, my studio practice. Yeah, I wonder what it is too. I'm one of those artists, I have a lot of friends who are painters, and I admire that they have this routine. You know, it's the romantic thing you guys imagine. You wake up whenever time that might be, and you have your coffee, and you read your paper, and you sit and look at a painting for an hour or so, and then you make a stroke or two, and then you have assistants stretching things and mixing up stuff. I have friends who do that. That thing is real. I don't do that. I wish I did. My life would be 10 times easier if I could just have that kind of routine. And so, consequently, I'm very hard on myself, thinking I should be in the studio, even when nothing's really in my mind, even when there's nothing happening. Sometimes that's good, because I fool around and make something that might make something else later. Other times, I realize that hanging out and going to hear music, or sitting around at the park, or over eavesdropping a conversation on the subway, or missing a flight and sitting in the waiting room and listening to conversations and people watching, I start jotting things down, and I find the ideas that I really get excited about come from that experience. It's sort of like the derive, or in Japanese, a sampo, when you go on a walk. And that walk is like a walking meditation. And that's where the inspiration comes from. Right there.
Is that sort of your process as well with the different videos that you watch? Because in the beginning, film, you're sort of putting together all these other people's videos together, making connections in a way that is bringing them
Yeah, that came from, I was asked to do, the question, if I heard it correctly, was that video montage I showed at the beginning, was that another part of my process, my creative process, of sitting down and culling all that information, that part of like my later sculpture and installation practice? Am I correct? Yeah, and the answer is yes. I was asked to do, to be a visiting lecturer at Harvard for a year, where I taught a class and then I did a commission for the school. And for that class, I wanted to do something very experimental. And I was going through all this theory and thought it might be good to introduce some of that theory to these students who may or may not know it. And because, you know, they were Harvard students, I'm sure they had something to bring to the table in terms of that. Then I realized that that really wasn't the message I was trying to get across. And that's not the stuff that I wanted to get back from them at the end of the day. So I sat in a library that had a VHS library and two old VHS cassettes that could digitize everything to computer, and I just went crazy and just started sampling and mixing and splicing, and that's where that came out of. So that is a process. I do that musically. I do that with books that I may read. So yeah, it's sort of like a pastiche diary type of thing. Was there a question over?
I have one more.
Sure.
Because you work with so many mediums, what's your studio space like?
I call it a light studio. Meaning that I don't have like serious welding equipment there, I don't have cranes, I don't have any of that. And I think this is also a symptom because for several years before I took the faculty position at Columbia and moved back there full time, I was doing residencies. So every other year, every other year or so, I might be in Germany for 6 or 7 months, or Hungary or Poland or Japan. So I had to develop strategies to still make work, but not get stuck with shipping materials, shipping supplies, shipping finished works back and forth. But at the same time, I don't want to just make ideas that don't have any physical form. So I've been still, and I think I'm still trying to figure out the best ways to make that work. With a light studio, that's the kind of place where I can make very small sculptures, discrete works, works on paper, paintings, drawings, and so on. I'm actually to the point now where I need a larger space just because I need more, real estate to even look at what I'm making. But for the larger projects, it ends up being site-specific and commission-based. So I spend a lot of time going back and forth to venues and figuring out who I can work with and that's nearby, who has facilities. I might even have to rent a place there for a couple of months to do full fabrication before a show starts. Yeah, I think some of the connections in there, I mean, it's really autobiographical. Like, for example, there's that breakdance segment where you have the guys pop-locking, and you have this music from an old Scholastic Rock figure eight cartoon that used to be on ABC or one of the stations during Cartoon Saturdays. And that's really how I grew up. I used to grow up with that little record, listening to those songs about number eight and number nine and number 10. And then I was watching Beat Street. A few years later. So I sort of put that all into some type of memory bank of nostalgic images from my past. And then there's also the sort of non sequitur stuff, like the Busby Berkeley that just sort of pops in the middle of nowhere. And then there was Bad Brains playing punk music before that, which is like one of the early black punk groups from the late 70s, early 80s. And then that goes into Soul Train. And I made that before Don Cornelius passed away, so it's sort of interesting that it ends on him. But so sometimes the relationships are very close, and sometimes it's totally disjointed. I have a tendency to have a lot of information in my work, and sometimes, as I'm probably doing now, I can over-explicate. So other times I like to, you know, butt rough edges against each other and let the viewer figure it out. There's another question I saw back here. Like they always say, nothing new under the sun. And, you know, it might have been a minstrel show 100 years ago, but it could be MTV, Yo MTV Raps last week. You know, you see these tropes over and over again. And once again, I think I've used some of these ideas so many times, like, you know, breakdancers on Buddhist mandalas. I didn't show you any of this, the smaller Buddhist sculptures that I did. I did clear cast Buddha sculptures that had fat shoelaces embedded inside, or microphones, or black leather medallions. So it was sort of really playing off the kitsch, rubbing the sacred against the sort of popular. And I think over the years I've started to develop the kind of vocabulary that now that I can throw those things out there, people like yourself can look at it and see how to connect some of those dots. Or maybe you don't connect them at all. I was speaking to a group of students earlier today, and I think a lot of this is becoming common visual knowledge, things that used to be foreign and you had to go out to do research for. You could just go on and somebody has another screensaver now. You know, I think I started to really think about that a lot when I saw people in their Land Rovers and Range Rovers in Connecticut and New York wearing a mink and then buying bulk goods from Whole Foods, green, Buddhist, eco-friendly, blah, blah, blah. I was joking with a friend this morning about everyone who goes to Whole Foods, and before they tell you what they got, they tell you what's not in it, as opposed to, you know, oh, it doesn't have this, it doesn't have this, it doesn't have that, but what does it have, you know? Anyway, that's neither here nor there, but another question? Yes?
Just your thoughts on posterity. Your work is very zen, and that it's in the present now, and it's hanging one place now, and that it's going to go away. Is that good? Bad? Problematical? Or do you not worry about it? It's not the Medici tomb. It's not. Permanence doesn't seem to be a big part of your work.
Permanence is an illusion. I mean, it's totally relative, isn't it? You know, we can consider something permanent, but the minute we're gone, does it really matter? So, everything I make will probably outlast everyone in this room, but will it be here for, you know, 300, 400 years? That's not my issue, I don't think. The pieces that I made, the sand pieces, the prayer rug, or the graffiti pieces I've done in sand, being a graffiti artist is about impermanence. It's about making a mark, and everyone who's an insider sees that mark, and then knowing full well that it could be erased the next day. And I think in some weird way that is very similar to the Buddhist notion of things being more important about the the impact they make on your mind as opposed to the impact they make on the physical world. All right, well, thank you all for coming.